Passion gets you a lot further. It makes you a better entrepreneur, a better leader, a better philanthropist, a better friend, a better lover. I want you to live the best life you can. You can be world changers. When you leave here today, you're going to look for a lot of things. Security, money, friendships, all kinds of things. But the most important thing you'll find is love. So love yourself, love your work, love the people around you. Dare to love those who are different from you, no matter where they're from, what they look like, and who they love. Pursue this life of love with focus and passion, ambition and courage. Give it your all, and that will be your path to true success.
Really, really feel what it would feel like to be in the action of what it is that you are dreaming of. And what does that feel like to be on the career path that is your dream? Or what does it feel like to be doing the work in the world that you've been so longing to bring forth? Or what does it feel like to be spreading an empowering message in a unique and innovative way? And in the process of gathering those feelings, we do it through meditation. Sit in your meditation for 2 to 3 minutes a day and just allow yourself to cultivate the feeling of what it is that you desire. I have had many experiences throughout my life where I've just allowed myself to be in the feeling of service or in the feeling of excitement of seeing myself on a stage or in the feeling of seeing myself sitting next to Oprah and doing an interview. And all of those emotional feelings that came forth in my meditations became the manifestations of my life. So take very seriously the thoughts and the feelings.
Start each day with a task completed. Find someone to help you through life. Respect everyone. Know that life is not fair and that you will fail often. But if you take some risks, step up when the times are the toughest, face down the bullies, lift up the downtrodden, and never ever give up. If you do these things, the next generation and the generations that follow will live in a world far better than the one we have today. And what started here will indeed have changed the world for the better.
Only thing that will change your life, change your business, change your money, change your relationship is you must raise your standard. What does that mean? That sounds so boring and dumb. It means that all of us in life, we don't get what we want. We get what we have to have. Remember I said earlier, we all get what we tolerate in ourselves and other people. But when you're no longer willing to tolerate something, that's when your life changes. The difference in people is their standards, period. And what do I mean by standards? Everyone in the world has a list of things they think they should do. I should lose weight. I should work out. I should spend more time with my kids. I should work harder. I should make more calls. I should. And then you know what? People don't do their shoulds, and they get mad at themselves, and they what I call shit all over themselves. They beat themselves up about it. What changes people is when your should becomes a must. When suddenly the thing you said should happen has to happen. That's when human beings change. It's like if you want to take the island, and you're the head of the army, and you want to take the island, the most powerful way to take the island is burn the boats. Because if there's no way to go back, it's amazing what happens when it's a must to do something versus a should.
Everybody has the same 24 hours to live out a day in their lives. Question is, what will you do with your 24 hours? Today, tomorrow, or the next? I challenge you to make each of those 24 hours, 24 hours of impact. Do yourself a favor. Get comfortable with silence. When you do, the important moments will seem louder. Close your eyes once in a while, and I promise you that you will see the important things clearer. And every now and then, let go of that tight grip that you have on your goals. When you do, it will be easier to enjoy the journey. Because believe me when I say, those audacious goals that you have will still be there.
How we perceive things, our lenses of perception, disclose the the kind of experience that we are going to have. The cynic sees everything like a drag. The cynic sees everything as dreary, infused with the banality of the everyday. His lenses of perception pollute, taint his experience of reality. The optimist sees bliss and possibility everywhere he looks. The optimist dwells in a place of unbounded potential. The optimist dares to conceive of what might be, and through his actions, potentiates ideas into being, right? The optimist ends up as a kind of sorcerer, as a kind of dream weaver, as a kind of alchemist that concocts and creates. The cynic shuns the world with a defeatist despair, living what Dostoevsky refers to as a quiet life of desperation. But as McKenna said, you are the sum of the people you spend the most amount of time with. And so if you wish to take control, to take agency over your lenses of perception, curate your life.
When you grow up, you tend to get told that the world is the way it is. Your life is just to live your life inside the world. Try not to bash into the walls too much. Try to have a nice family life. Have fun. Save a little money. But that's a very limited life. Life can be much broader once you discover one simple fact, and that is everything around you that you call life was made up by people that were no smarter than you. And you can change it. You can influence it. You can build your own things that other people can use. And the minute that you understand that you can poke life and actually something will, you know, if you push in, something will pop out the other side, you can change it, you can mold it. That's maybe the most important thing, is to shake off this erroneous notion that life is there and you're just going to live in it, versus embrace it, change it, improve it, make your mark upon it. I think that's very important. And however you learn that, once you learn it, you'll want to change life and make it better, because it's kind of messed up in a lot of ways. Once you learn that, you'll never be the same again.
If you did something wrong, don't let anybody take your mistake and use it against you. Even if it's a mistake, it belongs to you. It's yours. Own it. Yes, I did it. Throw it back in their face and don't let them take your mistake. Your mistake, it's a valuable tool for growth and for life. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. It's better than to do nothing and learn nothing and not evolve. Your mistake is your greatest opportunity. And if somebody's making fun of you because you made a mistake, don't go down because of it. Say so what to their face. They are powerless. They are powerless. Yes, I messed up. Tomorrow it will be another day. Next year will be another year. It is my mistake, not yours.
Like attracts like. These things that you expect come to you. And the more emotion you pour into anything, the more of that thing you receive. In other words, you can say one thing and do another. And as we well know, many of us typically say all the right things, but do we do them? If you don't believe me, go to somebody's house and look at all the dusty workout equipment. Look at all the diets that they tried. Go to a gym and look at the people that signed up that are no longer coming. Because what we have done is we've taken the laws of attraction and misapplied them. We don't take serious the things that we feel we deserve enough in order for them to manifest into our lives. And how do you stop that? Real simple. Monitor what you feel. What you constantly think about, that is exactly what you get.
It's quite an experience. I mean, it was an amazing idea to begin with, to embrace life in that way and to just allow the universe to take you where it's going to take you. So, total believer. Yeah, I believe in manifestation. I believe in putting a rocket of desire out into the universe. And you get it when you believe it. You get it when you believe you have it. And that's the key, is like people still, they sit around going, when's it gonna come, when's it gonna come, when's it gonna come, when's it gonna come? And that's the wrong way. You're facing the wrong way, you're facing away from it. You have to go, it's here, it's here, it's here.
A training class, having committed some egregious infraction of the rules, was ordered into the mud. The mud consumed each man till there was nothing visible but our heads. The instructors told us we could leave the mud if only five men would quit. Only five men, just five men, and we could get out of the oppressive cold. Looking around the mud flat, it was apparent that some students were about to give up. It was still over 8 hours till the sun came up. Eight more hours of bone-chilling cold. The chattering teeth and the shivering moans of the trainees were so loud, it was hard to hear anything. And then one voice began to echo through the night. One voice raised in song. The song was terribly out of tune, but sung with great enthusiasm. One voice became two, and two became three, and before long, everyone in the class was singing. The instructors threatened us with more time in the mud if we kept up the singing, but the singing persisted, and somehow the mud seemed a little warmer, and the wind a little tamer, and the dawn not so far away. If I have learned anything in my time traveling the world, it is the power of hope. The power of one person, a Washington, a Lincoln, King, Mandela, and even a young girl from Pakistan, Malala. One person can change the world by giving people hope. So if you want to change the world, start singing when you're up your neck in mud.
Life for me ain't been no crystal stad. It's had tacks in it, boards torn up places, with no carpet on the floor, bare. But all the time, I's been a-climbing on and reaching landings and turning corners and sometimes going in the dark where there ain't been no light. So, boy, don't you stop now. Don't you sit out on the steps because you find this kind of hard. But I's still going, boy. I's still climbing. And life for me ain't been no crystal stair. Well, life for none of us has been a crystal stair. But we must keep moving. We must keep going. If you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. If you can't walk, crawl. But by all means, keep moving.
So there was a wonderful article by Stephen Kotler published in Forbes about how to find your passion. It's a question we ask ourselves every single day. We've all been told that a life of passion is a life that means something. But how do we identify our passions? It's not always easy. So one of the things that Stephen Kotler breaks down is that he says that passion essentially exists in the intersection between multiple things that you're curious about. So he says the first thing you should do if you want to identify your passion is to make a list of all the things that you're curious about, all the things that you wonder about. Be as specific as you can. And then create kind of a Venn diagram and try to figure out where the things that you're curious about, three or more, intersect. And that's the sweet spot. That's where there is energy. That's where there is dopamine and neurobiology. And then once you've identified your passion, then you can figure out how to turn that passion into a purpose. Turn that passion into a purpose. Make a list of 15 things in the world, 15 challenges you'd like to see solved. And then figure out which one of those challenges can be served by your passion. So then you see, curiosity leads to passion. Multiple streams of curiosity leads to passion. Identifying problems in the world that can be served by your passion leads to purpose. Then, my friends, you've impregnated your life with a sense of significance, with a sense of meaning. Then you can go forth, my brothers. You can go forth.
Thought when we're young that the opposite of love is hate. But it's not. Hate is a byproduct. Hate is a result. Being a hater isn't cool. Nobody wants that. But hate comes from one thing, fear. And fear is the opposite of love. Fear is what blinds us. Fear is corrosive. Fear makes us hold back. It whispers to us, tells us that we'll fail. It tells us that our differences are too much to overcome. Fear locks us in place. It starts fights. It causes wars. And fear keeps us from loving. Even though we're made to love, we're often afraid to love. We're afraid of being hurt deeply, afraid of feeling the pain I went through when my parents were divorced. But you're never going to really love something or someone unless you put those fears aside. Don't hold back. Being in love means being ready to give freely and openly and being ready to risk something, risking pain and disappointment, conquering your fears and becoming anew. Alice Walker once said, "The more I wonder, the more I love." Love calls you to open your eyes, to seek, to search, to wonder. Love is all-consuming. It infiltrates your body. It allows you to experience bliss, joy, and true friendship. You'll be more disappointed when something goes wrong. You might fall harder. But the only way you'll reach any height in life and in love is by taking that chance that you might fall. You have to give your all.
Procrastinating is a form of fear, and it is difficult to acknowledge fear. But the truth is that you cannot create anything of value without both self-doubt and self-belief. Without self-doubt, you become complacent. Without self-belief, you cannot succeed. You need both. There will be times when you're petrified of failing, when fear of failure holds you back. In those moments, here is the truth that is easy to forget. You don't actually know that you will fail. Some of you here today, like me, know what you love, and some of you don't. If you don't know, you will. If not something that you love, then something that you like, or something that you don't hate, or something. You will find it. But to find it, you must try. The wonderful Shonda Rhimes said very wisely that you have to do something until you can do something else. Try. If it doesn't work out, try something else.
If you don't fail, you're not even trying. My wife told me this great expression: to get something you never had, you have to do something you never did. Les Brown's a motivational speaker. He made an analogy about this. He says, imagine you're on your deathbed, and standing around your deathbed are the ghosts representing your unfulfilled potential, the ghost of the ideas you never acted on, the ghost of the talents you didn't use. And they're standing around your bed, angry, disappointed, and upset. They say, we came to you because you could have brought us to life, they say. And now we have to go to the grave together. So I ask you today, how many ghosts are going to be around your bed when your time comes? What are you going to do with what you have? I'm not talking about how much you have. Some of you are business majors. Some of you are theologians, nurses, sociologists. Some of you have money. Some of you have patience. Some of you have kindness. Some of you have love. Some of you have the gift of long suffering. Whatever it is, whatever your gift is, what are you going to do with what you have?